a voice is raised and the mallet forms. The purpose of this seamless and rhythmical performance is the production of a traditional Japanese food called mochi. Mochi is a sticky dough made from steamed rice. It can be eaten just as it is, added to various dishes, or grilled. It's enjoyed in many ways. People often put mochi in soup, called zoni. It's an essential element of the New Year's home cooking in Japan. In ancient times, the Japanese believed that a divine presence dwelt within mochi. Eating this sacred food is seen as a prayer for health and good fortune. Farming regions of Japan seeking to boost their economic vitality have begun to make new mochi products from the rice they grow. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at mochi rice cake, a food steeped in history and the Japanese way of life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is mochi, which is a form of rice that's been preserved. We'll get into how it's made in just a moment, but it's been an integral part of the Japanese lifestyle for many, many hundreds of years. It's eaten all over Japan, and recipes vary from region to region. Today I'm in Akita, which is way up in the north of Japan. It's known for its rice growing. You can see some rice fields here behind me. They eat a lot of mochi here and all year round as well. We'll get into some regional recipes later on in the program, but first of all, take a look at how mochi is made.
Mochi is a much-loved Japanese food. It's made from rice, in particular a kind of glutinous rice called mochi rice. Let's see how it's made. Traditionally, the two essential tools for making mochi are a mortar and a mallet. Mochi making also requires at least two people. Mochi rice that has been left to soak overnight in water is steamed. To make mochi, the just steamed mochi rice is used. Before pounding, it's important that the rice be mashed. Once the grains of rice have lost their shape, the pounding begins. To pound the rice evenly all the way through, a second person must constantly add a little bit of water to maintain the right hardness of the mochi, and also flip the lump over again and again. After about 30 minutes of doing this in perfect harmony, the mochi is smooth and stretchy, ready for consumption. This is a mochi seller in Nara Prefecture. In front of the shop, a demonstration of high-speed mochi pounding draws a crowd of spectators. The mallet swings twice per second. The mallet man and the flipper must be perfectly synchronized, or else it's just impossible. I wanted to take a picture, but they move so fast I couldn't. Freshly made mochi is a source of delight for many people. This is the city of Ichinoseki in Iwate Prefecture. Today, local farmers have gathered to make mochi as part of a harvest ritual. In Japan, there's a custom of making mochi from newly harvested rice. Freshly pounded mochi is soft and stretchy. Bite-sized chunks are pulled off and eaten in various ways. Here is a famous one, mixed with aromatic sesame. It's also a good match for these little shrimps. And there is mochi in this bowl of viscous sauce and mushrooms. There's also natto mochi, a combination of mochi and natto, fermented whole soybeans. This too is popular. This, meanwhile, is a combination of mochi and sweetened mashed young soybeans. There are many ways of incorporating the fruits of the fields. We work hard all year, from the spring until the harvest. But when you eat mochi, all the hard work is worth it.
Kanpai!
Kanpai!
Pounding mochi requires a lot of collaboration. It helps to bring a community together. Freshly pounded mochi hardens over time, so people shape it into chunks for longer keeping. You can store it as round lumps and also as rectangular blocks. Blocks of mochi were first made around the 18th century. At the time, 1 million people were packed into the city of Tokyo, then called Edo. They lived in very cramped living conditions in single-story wooden row houses. Neighboring families would get together to pound mochi. In order to distribute it to a large number of people, it was found that making a slab of mochi and cutting it into blocks with a knife was faster than making round lumps one by one. Methods of preserving mochi also date back centuries. This is freeze-dried mochi. It was developed in cold regions to help mochi to keep longer. Blocks of mochi are wrapped in Japanese paper and tied up. After 2 or 3 days soaking in water, they're hung from the eaves in the winter air for about 2 months. The moisture content is driven out, and the resulting product will keep for a year. Grilling or boiling freeze-dried mochi restores it to its original stretchy consistency. These are just some of the ways in which mochi is prepared and enjoyed in Japan.
You can see there's mochi pounding going on right now, and this is great fun, especially for people who have aggressive tendencies. But you have to get the timing just right, because you don't want your partner losing any fingers. I'm hoping they're going to let me have a go. Thank you very much. Okay, so I guess I go bang, and then she gives me the words. Here we go. Oh. Splashes a lot as well. It's actually more tiring than I thought. This is pretty heavy, this thing. Lots of fun, though. You get to work it all off.
To get together at a place like this, work together, and make mochi together, and also drink tea and chat a little, it's all fun.
So this is the completed pounded mochi now. Oh, it's still warm and quite firm as well. I can't wait to have a taste of this, I can tell you. And this is the feast that the ladies have put together for me. We've got 3 different types of mochi here. These ones are sesame. In the middle here, these are soybean flour. And these red ones, you have these red beans called azuki, which have been sweetened with sugar, and they've got the mochi inside. It's kind of Japan's answer to New Orleans' red beans and rice, if you like. So I'm going to try all of these. I'm going to pig out completely. And they're all delicious from prior experience. Let's start with sesame then. Some sugar in there is with the sesame as well. Oh, it's gorgeous. Okay, while I continue gorging myself on all this delicious food, in Japan, mochi is not just another kind of food. It's been regarded as sacred for many centuries now. Let's take a look now at some different customs involving mochi.
In ancient Japan, rice had a spiritual significance because it was seen as nurturing the life force of human beings. Considered sacred, mochi a lump of pounded rice was not only eaten but played a role in many rituals. That's still true today. Mochi is especially important around the New Year. This is Kagami Mochi, literally mirror mochi. It's put on display in the home, usually in a traditional decorative alcove or in the kitchen. Kagami Mochi is made with the most recently harvested rice. A sizable lump is placed on a larger lump to symbolize the accumulating years. This reflects a wish for a long life. At the very top is a citrus fruit. This stands for the prosperity of the household. Other forms of mochi are designed to appeal to the eye, like these flower mochi. No flowers grow during the harsh winter in Japan's deep snow regions, so people take twigs and wrap bits of mochi around them to create attractive interior arrangements. This is one way to make the most of a long, cold winter. This event brings traditional New Year's festivities to an end. It features mochi. On or around January the 15th, communities gather to burn their special New Year's decorations made of bamboo and straw. Mochi is stuck to the end of bamboo poles and roasted in the bonfire. It's said that eating this mochi will ensure a year of good health. Mochi also plays a key role on the most important occasions in life. Like baby's first steps, performed ceremonially by strapping a 1.5 kilogram lump of mochi to the back of a 1-year-old. This ritual expresses a wish for a life of material well-being. Children grow up and get married. At this wedding reception, people in traditional festival outfits pound mochi. In many regions of Japan, mochi pounding is arranged for special occasions. The stickiness of the mochi symbolizes a wish that the couple will enjoy a strong, lasting bond. When a new house is built, mochi again makes an appearance. This ritual tells the guardian deity of the land that the building is nearing completion. It's a way to show appreciation to the deity. To celebrate the family building the home, throw mochi to their neighbors who have gathered for this occasion. All the way from birth to maturity, mochi is woven into the fabric of life.
They even have a mochi museum here, and it has a mind-boggling array of different dishes all using mochi. I think even a lot of Japanese people would be surprised to see this many different things. Some of them are historical, you wouldn't see them very much today. They come from all different regions of Japan, but there are some which are still extant now. For example, this one here, which has a round mochi display with some stick beans. This is part of a sort of harvest festival thing. It's used to give thanks for the harvest and to express people's wishes for an equally good harvest the next year. And then over here we have this rather interesting diamond-shaped one. This one is well known to a lot of Japanese people. It's a decoration that's used as part of the girls' festival. They have traditional dolls and a number of decorations that go with them. Again, this is to express the wish for your children to grow up healthy and prosperous. There are all sorts of dishes using mochi in Japan. One that everybody always has as part of the New Year celebration is a kind of soup. It's called zoni in Japanese, and it comes in a wild variety of different recipes according to the different region, the different household even. What it always has in common is that it includes mochi. Let's take a look at some of the different varieties you'll find around Japan.
Zoni is a kind of soup which is an essential part of a New Year's meal in Japan. Its ingredients include mochi, vegetables, meat, and seafood. there is a kaleidoscopic range of regional varieties. And every household seems to have its own recipe. Traditional foods researcher Ayao Okumura has crisscrossed Japan for 10 years. He studies the zoni recipes in each region. Zoni recipes are passed down in families from generation to generation. They epitomize the culinary heritage of each family. These traditions often date back many years. Okumura's research indicates that there are three broad categories of zoni. The most common type features a clear broth with a seafood base. This is eaten in eastern Japan and in Kyushu, the southernmost main island. Hisa Okamoto lives in Chiba Prefecture in eastern Japan. She makes her broth with dried bonito. It's a preserved food product made through a process of repeated cycles of fermentation and drying. It's an essential ingredient in Japanese cuisine. The dried bonito is so hard it must be shaved using a plane. Flakes of dried bonito are put in hot water to extract the essence. The flavored broth is poured over the mochi, and then a kind of taro which has been boiled is added. The soup is topped with a generous sprinkling of grilled seaweed. This particular type of seaweed is gathered in the south of Chiba Prefecture. Only a limited amount is available, and it's a treasured and expensive local ingredient that adds a salty aroma to the kind of zoni made in the Okamoto household. At the new year, I want to enjoy our own local seaweed. That's what I grew up on. Without eating that, it just wouldn't feel like the new year. Zoni recipes often rely heavily on local ingredients. This is Niigata Prefecture on the Sea of Japan. In the autumn, salmon surge up local rivers. Sumie Endo was born and raised here. The zoni recipe that she learned from her mother makes heavy use of salmon, in particular boiled salmon roe. Boiled salmon roe is used to garnish zoni that also includes salmon flesh. You want the roe to just cook very briefly before it's added to the soup. I plan to keep on making it this way. The next most common category of zoni uses a miso base. It's found in the Kinki region, including Kyoto and Nara. The white miso widely used in Kyoto is known for its refined flavor. The Sugimoto family in Kyoto have maintained aspects of a traditional lifestyle for 260 years. This manual handed down in the family for two centuries records how to do things. Here is the New Year's meal it specifies. The zoni features taro with a mochi ball on top. The broth has a kelp seaweed base flavored with white miso. And finally, dried bonito flakes are added. The Chugoku region of central Japan has an unusual variant of zoni. It's based on azuki beans, which are either salted or sweetened with sugar. Tokyo is populated by people hailing from every part of Japan. You'll find places in the big city that serve zoni from the regions. This udon noodle restaurant is run by a man who hails from Takamatsu, a city in Kagawa Prefecture. In early January, it offers a special zoni. The broth is based on white miso, and the mochi has a sweet azuki bean paste filling. This is a typical Kagawa recipe. The owner was once a student in Tokyo, yet he felt so lonely when he was stranded in the big city at the new year without access to his hometown zoni. So he decided to order all the necessary ingredients from home and make it for other people like him from Kagawa Prefecture. It has to have that sweet azuki bean paste in it. That's what makes the new year such an enjoyable time. Times may change, but one thing stays the same. The Japanese attachment to a specific local variety of zoni. Here's a bowl of zoni for you.
Thank you very much.
It has chicken, burdock root, maitake mushrooms, Japanese parsley, and some other kinds of vegetables in there, and it's seasoned with soy sauce.
Slightly salty, but not too salty. Very nice indeed. Well, my wife is Japanese, so the kind of zoni that we have at New Year's is the recipe that she grew up with in her own home. But when two Japanese people get married, it's not necessarily that simple. The wife is perhaps going to want to cook the kind of zoni that she grew up with. The husband is maybe going to want to eat the type that he grew up with. So they have to strike a kind of compromise, and sometimes they'll do it alternate years or something like that. All right, let's move on now and take a look at a rural village that has used mochi to try and revitalize its economy.
Nestled in the mountains of northern Okayama Prefecture is the village of Shinjo. It's a small farming community of around 1,000 people. The pristine natural setting is a point of pride in the village. Abundant groundwater feeds sparkling streams in the town. But the village has little industry and very few employment opportunities besides farming. About 40% of the population is 65 or over, the highest ratio in Okayama Prefecture. Village mayor Hiroshi Sasano came up with a plan based on himeno mochi, a type of mochi rice made locally. His aim was to make this an economic engine for the village. Many people say that what will revitalize an area is usually right under your nose. In the case of Shinjo Village, himeno mochi was exactly that, a village treasure and a catalyst for reviving the local economy. Himeno mochi is an improved strain of mochi rice that was bred almost 50 years ago for growing in colder climates. The temperature extremes characteristic of Shinjo's climate give the rice an extra glutinous quality that locals have always loved. The villagers came up with a plan to process this rice into an original line of mochi products. Mochi has always been eaten in Shinjo all through the year. Eight years ago, the mayor launched an initiative to draw on the mochi-making expertise of local farm families to get mochi processing going as an industry. In mid-October, as the new rice crop begins to come in, the village begins to make mochi. It has long been the tradition in the village for housewives to get together in someone's home to make mochi, with everyone bringing their own rice. Now they gather in a modern workspace. Original products emerge from daily conversation. The housewives have vivid imaginations, and they have thought up new ways of enjoying mochi. The village currently produces 13 kinds of mochi. This is an extra thin style for use in hot pots. It softens right away when put in the broth, making it easy to eat. These mochi dumplings with azuki bean paste are filled with fresh cream for a milky taste. But a village of 1,000 people lacks access to established sales channels. So the villagers decided to pitch their wares themselves in big cities like Tokyo. They hawk their mochi in person at more than 70 locations every year. And in the process, they have won over individual fans as well as long-established restaurants. Next door to a roadside market in the village, a processing facility was built and greatly boosted the volume of mochi production. It has become a critical employer for young people in a village that otherwise lacks jobs. In spite of depopulation and aging, these people want to fight for the continued existence of their village, and their mochi is a testament to their determination.
The village that we've just seen has a union which takes over farm work for some of the older farmers who can no longer work in the fields. That way fewer fields lie fallow and also their harvest has increased. There are lots of ways of eating mochi. I'd like to leave you with one very simple one which anybody can do. You can see the mochi heating on the fire here. As it gets warm, you take some nori. This is the kind of seaweed that you often see in sushi rolls. You take some soy sauce, dip it in there, and just munch. Absolutely amazing. For a good winter snack to really warm you up, I recommend it to anybody. And with that, I shall take my leave of you, and I'll see you again next time.
In particular, a kind of glutinous rice called mochi rice. Let's see how it's made. Traditionally, the two essential tools for making mochi are a mortar and a mallet. Mochi making also requires at least two people. Mochi rice that has been left to soak overnight in water is steamed. To make mochi, the just steam mochi rice is used. Before pounding, it's important that the rice be mashed. Once the grains of rice have lost their shape, the pounding begins. To pound the rice evenly all the way through, a second person must constantly add a little bit of water to maintain the right hardness of the mochi, and also flip the lump over again and again. After about 30 minutes of doing this in a voice is raised and the mallet falls. The purpose of this seamless and rhythmical performance is the production of a traditional Japanese food called mochi. Mochi is a sticky dough made from steamed rice. It can be eaten just as it is, added to various dishes, or grilled. It's enjoyed in many ways. People often put mochi in soup, called zoni. It's an essential element of the New Year's home cooking in Japan. In ancient times, the Japanese believed that a divine presence dwelt within mochi. Eating this sacred food is seen as a prayer for health and good fortune. Farming regions of Japan, seeking to boost their economic vitality, have begun to make new mochi products from the rice they grow. Perfect harmony, the mochi is smooth and stretchy, ready for consumption. This is a mochi seller in Nara Prefecture. In front of the shop, a demonstration of high-speed mochi pounding draws a crowd of spectators. The mallet swings twice per second. The mallet man and the flipper must be perfectly synchronized, or else it's just impossible. I wanted to take a picture, but they move so fast I couldn't. Freshly made mochi is a source of delight for many people. This is the city of Ichinoseki in Iwate Prefecture. Today, local farmers have gathered to make mochi as part of a harvest ritual. In Japan, there's a custom. On this edition of Begin Japanology, we look at mochi rice cake, a food steeped in history and the Japanese way of life.
Hello and welcome to Begin Japanology. I'm Peter Barakan. Our theme for today is mochi, which is a form of rice that's been preserved. We'll get into how it's made in just a moment, but it's been an integral part of the Japanese lifestyle for many, many hundreds of years. It's eaten all over Japan, and recipes vary from region to region. Today I'm in Akita, which is way up in the north of Japan. It's known for its rice growing. You can see some rice fields here behind me. They eat a lot of mochi here and all year round as well. We'll get into some regional recipes later on in the program, but first of all, take a look at how mochi is made.
Mochi is a much-loved Japanese food. It's made from rice, of making mochi from newly harvested rice. Freshly pounded mochi is soft and stretchy. Bite-sized chunks are pulled off and eaten in various ways. Here is a famous one, mixed with aromatic sesame. It's also a good match for these little shrimps. And there is mochi in this bowl of viscous sauce and mushrooms. There's also natto mochi, a combination of mochi and natto, fermented whole soybeans. This too is popular. This, meanwhile, is a combination of mochi and sweetened mashed young soybeans. There are many ways of incorporating the fruits of the fields.